जय हिंद स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू माय यूट्यूब चैनल। स्टूडेंट्स, अ रिवर कट्स थ्रू अ रॉक नॉट बिकॉज ऑफ इट्स पावर बट बिकॉज ऑफ इट्स परसिस्टेंस। सो स्टूडेंट्स, हैव परसिस्टेंस। इफ यू हैव परसिस्टेंस देन यू विल कंटिन्यू टू डू योर वर्क इन स्पाइट ऑफ एनी हर्डल्स, ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन और हिंड्रेंसेस।
नाउ लेट अस डिस्कस the relationship between momentum and kinetic energy. Now students, let us consider a body of mass m. Consider a body of mass m. Suppose it is moving with velocity v. We are aware momentum of a body is defined as the net amount of motion contained in a body, isn't it? So therefore, the linear momentum of the body, which is represented by P, it will be given by the product of mass of the body and its velocity, right? And also students, the kinetic energy, which is the energy possessed by the body by virtue of its motion, that is given by, suppose E, capital letter E, it's equal to half mv square, right? So, we need to determine the relationship between kinetic energy and the momentum. So, what to do is, E is equal to 1 by 2 mv square. Here, what to do is, multiply and divide both the sides, I mean the numerator as well as denominator, by m. So what we get is, we can write like this, 1 by 2 mv square. So we are multiplying the numerator as well as denominator by m. So what we get is, kinetic energy is equal to 1 by 2m, and in the numerator we'll get m square v square, that is mv whole square. Now students, from equation 1, mv is equal to linear momentum. Therefore, kinetic energy is equal to p square divided by 2m. So, this is the relationship between the kinetic energy and the momentum of a body. Kinetic energy is equal to p square divided by 2m, or it may also be written like this, p square is equal to twice me, which implies that momentum is equal to square root of twice me. So this is the relationship between the linear momentum and the kinetic energy of the body. Right? So therefore, a body cannot have momentum without having kinetic energy, and vice versa. I repeat students, from the above it's pretty clear that a body cannot have momentum without having kinetic energy, and its vice versa is also true. That is, a body cannot have kinetic energy without momentum of the body. Clear? So now let us discuss the relationship between momentum and kinetic energy graphically. Right? So, first and foremost, let us discuss the variation between the kinetic energy, E stands for the kinetic energy, and P is the momentum. Momentum is a vector quantity, so it can be positive, negative, or even zero, isn't it? So, here E and P, the relationship is E is equal to P square divided by 2m. So, if mass is constant, mass of a given body is constant only. So, in that case, E is proportional to P square, isn't it? If M is constant. Therefore, students, it is in the standard form of a parabola, isn't it? The degree is 2. Therefore, the graph would be like this. This is the graph obtained between the kinetic energy and the momentum. So the nature of the graph between the kinetic energy and the momentum would be a parabola. This is the first graph. Let's consider other case. Let us plot graph between root of kinetic energy, square root of E, and the momentum. Now look, here students, P is equal to root 2 ME. M being constant, from this equation, it's pretty clear that P is directly proportional to square root of E, isn't it? So if you plot a graph between P and square root of E, which is kinetic energy, then they are linearly dependent. What I mean to say is that the graph obtained between P and root E must be a straight line passing through the origin. It is in the form of y equals to mx, right? So it should be a straight line. So the graph between P and root E is a straight line. Here m is obviously constant. So it is a straight line. Okay, now consider third scenario as well. What to do is, let us consider the graph to be plotted between the kinetic energy and the mass of our body. Suppose we consider a system where the mass of the system varies and the momentum is constant. So here we'll consider P to be constant. So if P is constant, from this equation, kinetic energy would be inversely proportional to the mass of the body, isn't it, students? So in that case, the graph obtained between E and M would be a hyperbola. It will be like this. It will touch at infinity. This will also touch at infinity, right? So in this case, if the momentum is constant, then the nature of the graph is a hyperbola. So this is basically a hyperbola. So these are the various graphs showing the variation between the kinetic energy and the momentum. Here it's between the momentum and square root of the kinetic energy. And here it's the graph between the kinetic energy and the mass of the body, provided momentum of the body is constant. Clear, students? Students, let us try to attempt these three numericals based on the relationship between the kinetic energy and the momentum. Let's start with the first question. The kinetic energy of a body is increased by 21%. What is the percentage increase in the linear momentum of the body? So, we are already aware the relationship between momentum and kinetic energy. Momentum is, students, square root of twice ME. That's the relationship between the momentum and the kinetic energy. And here, for a given body, mass is constant. For a given body, M is constant. And therefore, linear momentum of the body is directly proportional to the square root of the kinetic energy, right? So we'll have to make use of this particular relationship. Here, students, new kinetic energy. It is increased by 21%. So original kinetic energy plus 21% of original kinetic energy. So that will give us E plus 21 by 100 into E. So it will be equal to 1.21 E. Right? This is the new kinetic energy. Also, we are supposed to find out the percentage increase in the linear momentum. It will be equal to the increase in the linear momentum divided by original value multiplied by 100. Always remember, students, the formula for the percentage change is the change in the physical quantity, which is given by the final value minus the initial value. And percentage change would be change in the quantity divided by its original value multiplied by 100. So it would be equal to P dash by P minus 1 into 100. It can be written like this. Now P is directly proportional to square root of the energy. So P dash by P would be equal to square root of E dash by E minus 1 multiplied by 100. Right? So E dash is given to be 1.21 of E divided by E minus 1 into 100. So E get cancelled. Right? Square root of 1.21 is 1.1 minus 1 into 100. So that will give you 1.1 minus 1 is 0.1. 0.1 multiplied by 100 is 10%. And this is positive sign. It means that it is the case of percentage increase. Right? So as the kinetic energy of the body is increased by 21%, the linear momentum of the body will get increased by 10%. So that is the approach which is to be followed. Let's proceed with the next question then. Next question is, the momentum of a body is increased to twice its original value. What is the corresponding percentage increase in the kinetic energy of the body? Okay, so we are aware E is equal to P square divided by twice M, isn't it? It is the same relation, squaring both the sides and rearrange the terms, we should get this. So we are aware of it. Kinetic energy is equal to the square of the momentum divided by twice into mass of the body. Now here, students, for a given body, again mass is constant. Mass would be constant. So if mass is constant, then kinetic energy would be directly proportional to square of the momentum. Clear, students? So in this case, we are supposed to find out the corresponding percentage change in the kinetic energy. So that would be given by E dash minus E. This is the change in the kinetic energy divided by original value multiplied by 100. So this gives us the percentage change in the kinetic energy of the body. So it may be written as E dash by E minus 1 into 100. Now E is proportional to P square. So it may be written as P dash square divided by P square minus 1 multiplied by 100. P dash is the new momentum. And it is given in the question that the new momentum of the body is increased to twice its original value. So as per the question, it is given that new momentum is equal to twice the original momentum. Therefore, coming back to this, P dash is equal to twice P. So what you get is 2p whole square. It will give us 4p square by p square. P square, p square get cancelled. So we'll be left with 4 minus 1. That is 3. 3 multiplied by 100. That is 300%. So students, if the momentum of the body is increased to twice its original value, then the kinetic energy will get increased by 300%. So that's the answer. Let's proceed with the third one. The kinetic energy of a body is decreased by 36%. What is the percentage decrease in the linear momentum of the body? Okay, as per the question, the kinetic energy, suppose it is represented by E dash, is decreased by 36%. So this is the original minus 36% of original value. That is, E dash would be equal to E minus 36 by 100 of E. So that will give us 64 by 100 E. So that will give us 0.64E. So if the kinetic energy of a body is decreased by 36%, so 64% will be left. That is, new kinetic energy would be equal to 64% of its original kinetic energy. Or in fraction, it will be given by 0.64 of E. Now, coming back to the question, we are supposed to find out the percentage decrease in the linear momentum of the body. So, what's the relationship? We know that linear momentum is given by square root of twice ME. And for a given body, mass is constant. Therefore, P is directly proportional to square root of the energy, isn't it? Therefore, students, we need to find out the percentage change. So, percentage change in the physical quantity is change in the physical quantity, which is the final value minus original value, divided by original value multiplied by 100. So, this, as I've stated earlier, it may be written as P dash by P minus 1 multiplied by 100. Now, P is proportional to square root of the kinetic energy. So, P dash by P would be equal to square root of E dash divided by E minus 1 multiplied by 100. Isn't it? So, it will be equal to E dash. Now, E dash is given to be 0.64E divided by E minus 1 into 100. So that will give us square root of 0.64 minus 1 multiplied by 100. So that will in turn give us square root of 0.64 is 0.8 minus 1 multiplied by 100. So 0.8 minus 1 is minus 0.2 multiplied by 100, that is minus 0.2 multiplied by 100. So it will give us minus 20%. So minus sign represents that the linear momentum is decreasing. Right? So the percentage decrease in the linear momentum of the body is 20%. Right? So therefore, percentage decrease in the linear momentum is 20%. This negative sign suggests that it is the case of percentage decrease. Now students, let us discuss the concept of instantaneous power. And in the earlier session, we have already discussed about power. As we are aware, power is defined as the time rate of doing work, isn't it? We all are aware that power is defined as the time rate of doing work. That is, when the time taken to complete a given amount of work is important, we measure the power of the agent doing work, right? So the average power, it can be mathematically represented like this, P bar or P average. So average power delivered by an agent is given by work done per unit time, right? W is the amount of work done in time T. So power, as you are aware, is the ratio of two scalars, work and time. So obviously, power is a scalar quantity. So this is an important point. Remember, power is a scalar quantity. That is, it is having only magnitude but no direction. Clear? So basically, if the time taken to complete a given amount of work is more, then the power is less. And if the time taken to complete a given amount of work is less, then the power would be more. Also, students, in terms of dot product, we are aware work done is given by the scalar product of force and displacement. Therefore, the power, average power, it would be given by, in place of W, you can write scalar product of force and displacement divided by time, right? So, displacement divided by time is velocity. So, it can also be written as F vector dot V vector. Therefore, there's a very, very important relationship. Average power is given by the scalar product of force and velocity. This is the dot product. So, by using the concept of scalar or dot product, we can write it as FV cosine of the smaller angle between the force and the velocity. Right? So, this is an important relation which you need to remember. So, power, it's given by the scalar product of force and velocity. Theta, remember, it's the small angle between F and V. Now, in case F and V point in the same direction, in case the force acts on the body along the direction of its motion, then obviously theta would be equal to 0 and cos 0 is 1. In that case, power is simply given by the product of magnitude of the force and the velocity. Clear, students? Now, let us talk about the instantaneous power. Instantaneous means at a given instant. So, instantaneous power is the power at any given instant. It may be defined as the power of the agent or the body at any given instant, at any given instant, and it is denoted by P. And students, you are aware, we can represent instantaneous power by using calculus. Now suppose an agent does an infinitesimally small amount of work dW in an infinitesimally small time dt, then the instantaneous power P is represented by dW divided by dt. It is actually the differential coefficient of work with respect to time. It is the first derivative of work with respect to time. Here dW represents the infinitesimally small amount of work performed by an agent in small time dt. Right? Also, in calculus we are aware the small amount of work done, it's given by the scalar product of force and infinitesimally small displacement. Therefore, the instantaneous power, here P is the instantaneous power, it is given by F vector dot ds vector divided by dt. That is, the instantaneous power is given by the scalar product of force and velocity. Clear, students? So, instantaneous power is the power of an agent or the power of a body at any given instant of time. So, power of an agent at any instant is equal to the dot or the scalar product of the applied force and the velocity at that instant. Now, when an agent delivers power at a uniform rate, then the average power is equal to the instantaneous power, right? And we are also aware of the units of power. The SI unit of power is watt. SI unit of power is watt. So, power is work done over time taken. So, 1 watt is equal to 1 joule divided by 1 second. So, when an agent performs 1 joule of work in 1 second, then the power of the agent is said to be 1 watt. Again, I repeat, students, the power of an agent is said to be 1 watt if it performs 1 joule of work in 1 second. Clear? So, there are other various units as well. 1 kilowatt, it is equal to 1000 watt, then 1 megawatt. It is equal to, mega means 10 is to a 6 watt. Then another very commonly used unit of power is horsepower. 1 horsepower, it is equal to 746 watt. So these are various practical units of power, right? Kilowatt, megawatt and horsepower. SI unit of power is watt. Now regarding its dimensional formula. Now let us find out the dimensional formula of power. Dimensional formula, right? Power, as you are aware, it is 1 watt. It is work done, that is joule divided by second. Let us try to represent it in terms of basic or fundamental units. Joule is Newton meter. Newton is, students, kg meter per second square. So if you solve it, what we are going to get is kg meter square. It will give us s to the power minus 3. Therefore, the dimensional formula for power is m L2 t to the power minus 3. So this is the dimensional formula for power. So students, I hope you have understood the concept. Now there is a conceptual question. Can you tell me what is represented by the slope of work time graph? Yes, slope of work time graph. Obviously, it will give us instantaneous power, right? Power is work done over time taken. So if you plot a graph between work done and time taken, then this slope, if work is represented along y-axis and time is represented along x-axis, then obviously its slope will give us the instantaneous power, right? So I hope, students, you have enjoyed this session. You have understood this concept of kinetic energy, then the relationship between kinetic energy and momentum. Some numericals have been discussed related to kinetic energy and momentum. And then we have discussed power and instantaneous power, right? So that's it for this particular session, students. Do take very good care of yourself and do join me in my next video then. Thank you.